This is Niswander, and welcome to the Nowman Show. And once again, I am here with pianist, composer extraordinaire, Mike Garson. And it's a pleasure to welcome you back to the Nowman Show. This is our technically our fourth episode and our third meeting, so it's...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Nice to be here. That was a piece that I wrote for Bill Evans. Sometimes pieces, they go dormant for 10, 20 years, and then I recently started playing again, and you play them till you don't want to play them again, but that was a improvised version, except for the melody, obviously, of this waltz I wrote for Bill, who was very dear to my heart, blessed to have had a six-hour lesson with him, and saw him so many times at the Village Vanguard, so he was a big influence on my life. I would sit almost this close to where the piano was at the club. And it was a beautiful experience.
Did he ever have a group to play with, or was he mostly just solo keyboard?
No, he had always a great trio. He did some solo records, but he had an amazing trio with a bass player named Scott LaFaro in early 1960, and a drummer named Paul Motion. And then Scott passed away. I think it might have been a car accident. And then people like Eddie Gomez and mm-hmm. Chuck Israels, they came in. Great, great. He always had amazing trios, but I was very lucky to be able to drive down from Brooklyn into New York City to the Village Vanguard, which is still there, and watch those shows. Big influence on my life.
Fantastic. So Village Vanguard still does jazz shows?
Mm-hmm. Still there.
Have you been back there to play yourself?
I haven't played there. I played at the Blue Note with Stanley Clarke, but I haven't played at the Village Vanguard recently, no.
And you were with Stanley, like, in between gigs with David, right?
Yes, I worked with Stanley in 78 and 79, and then we toured all the Blue Notes in Japan, New York, and Tokyo, and Osaka. We did that in around 1998. We never even have released any of those recordings. We have more recorded on DATs, maybe 40, 50 hours.
Wow. So there's some other stuff, too. Are you in touch with Stanley on that?
I saw him at we both did a played at a benefit for KTLA. It was a KPFK. KPFK is the one. Yeah, in town. We did a benefit for them both about 2 months ago. So I saw him there. I hadn't seen him for a while.
Oh, wow. I need to reconnect with them. I was the community advisory board chair there for a few years, and they've...
Connect with him. His portion of the show was with upright bass, and he had a tabla player or some Latin instruments from Afghanistan. Wow. It was amazing. The two of them together, just bass. Yeah. It was really nice.
I love when people mix instruments up like that. And I saw Herbie Hancock once do that with, and he's brilliant in that, you know, how you can just, as you yourself, you know, you combine different styles of music together, and you can bring in, you can sneak in all different kinds of sounds and instruments, yes, you know, depending on how you do it.
The world's becoming a smaller place, so we need to be aware and co-create with other great cultures. You know, I've done that a lot. I used to jam in the 80s with tabla players.
Fantastic.
Just for the fun of it.
Oh yeah, it's great. Yeah, and let's capture a little bit of the timeline of since last time we talked. My gosh, it was 2017 since we actually had a conversation like this. So I know you did a recording, which is a charity benefit with Gabby Moreno. Ian Heavy, he's my brother. That's beautiful.
That, we did a nice version of that. I think we were doing it. It had twofold purpose. We did it for cancer, and we also did it for the fires, the firemen. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, she's a very talented singer, Gabby Moreno, and she's going to have a very good career. It has been good, and it's going to continue being good. She's a wonderful singer.
And she's very versatile, too, as an artist, and I think.
Yeah. I just did a big project with her, and she just could sing very wide net.
And I think she, on that recording, sounded like she did all the harmonies too, I think, and it was phenomenal.
All the harmonies on He Ain't Heavy. And we did it all in my other studio, and it was just watching her work for 3 hours and got it all done. It was amazing.
Wow, you did that in 3 hours?
Yes.
Wow. Very impressive. I really enjoyed it a lot.
Great.
Yeah. And in 2018... I know there was a lot going on then, because I've seen all the Bowie Celebration shows here in L.A., you worked with a lot of interesting people in the last few years on those shows. Then there's, let's see, what was it, Earl Slick, there was, and so even Angelo Moore was there. And
the early shows, Angelo Moore, very talented singer, yes.
Yeah, who else did I see? And Adrian Ballou. And, of course, you had Gail and Sterling.
And Sterling Campbell. There have been about 100 singers that have worked with us, and probably over 25 different alumni. On this tour coming up January through April on a Bowie celebration, the whole band is alumni from different parts of David's life. the drummer is named Alan Childs. He played with David on a Glass Spider tour. So he was out for a year. Carl Mine, Rowhouse was out with him playing bass. And I'm using a guitar player named Kevin Armstrong, who you might not know, who's terrific. He wrote the title track Outside with David, and he played on Absolute Beginners, which was a great Bowie song. So, but I had never connected with him in the Bowie Celebration. I had worked with him on another project. He's been out with Iggy Pop as the musical director the last 5-6 years. Oh. Then we have, yeah, so he's great. And then we have Jerry Leonard, who's been with David. He did the reality tour with us, and he was musical director. And he's a wonderful guitar player and great on ambient sounds, but he can do everything. So, and myself, so, and then we have, in the States, we have actually Corey Glover from Living Color. He's wonderful. We have Sting's son, Joe Sumner. And then we're going to have, I'm bringing a female vocalist from Canada down. She's like a Janis Joplin. She's amazing. Her name is Sass Jordan. So she sat in with us in Canada the last 2 years. I said, I need more of her. So she's going to do the whole American tour and Canadian tour, which will be in March into early April. So we have, a great band, but this will be like my fourth band since David passed. And they're always great because everybody's there to support the music. The fans are singing every word to every song. It's heartwarming. And I'm really looking forward to this band. And this, I just came from London actually doing a stripped down version with some singers over there.
Including Mark Allman from Soft Cell, right?
Mark Allman was great. He sang My Death, and it's just die for. And he loved the version that I sent him that not too many have heard that I did with David in the Manhattan Center in the 90s. It was just piano and voice. It was just gorgeous. So we used that as a template, and he sang it beautiful. Plus, we did some of his songs, Tainted Love, and we did...
Sex Dwarf, did you do that one?
No, we did one called Say Hello, Wave Goodbye, which he wrote. It was a very cute song, and the audience got a kick out of it. And there was another great singer named Simon Westbrook, who's just local, but just really understood the music. And then I had a piano, two vocalists, and this, what was hilarious, I had two sax players.
Oh, really?
No drums, no bass.
Really?
No guitar, just two sax players, and one of them did some background vocals, and that was Claire Hurst. She actually was at Live Aid with David. She played with him back in the 80s.
She's singing?
She was playing sax. She does background vocals, but she's a good sax player. And then a guy named Terry Edwards, who, when I did Aladdin's Aim with him, this is just a week ago, he played two saxes at the same time. So we had, the audience went crazy, you know, and Mark Ammon sang it with this guy, Simon, and was two vocals. It was really wonderful. So I'm finding I'm able to do the Bowie thing in many contexts, very simple, the larger bands. I eventually will do some orchestra ones, and it's just continuously evolving. But we have 40 shows coming up in the next 4 or 5 months, and last year was 60 shows, and next year will be his fifth anniversary since he's passed.
Wow.
So I'll probably even do more shows that year. Might even be 70 shows, you know. So
that's that would be like the 5 years tour, right?
That's what it's going to be called.
Yeah.
That's what it's going to be called. And, you know, I'm not tired of his music.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just not tired of it. And I have so much room to do what I want because he always gave me room. So why shouldn't I do it with my own bands, you know? So there's a lot of room. And
that's the mindset of Bowie, though, is to, like, take a song and then just let it happen, let it make itself with the musicians.
Partially because his trust level of the people he hired was so high that he knew it would always come out all right. He never micromanaged. He did very little except give maybe a vision. Mm-hmm. And he would trust. And every musician he ever hired was the perfect one. So you'd have to say he was the ultimate casting director. That's sort of how I see him that way. And a great producer. And he pulled out the best of me. It was almost like whatever I had practiced my first 20 years of my life, he found a place for in the maybe 100 songs I recorded with him.
And you worked on, so you did 20 albums and 9 tours, right?
It might have even been 13 tours. There were some smaller ones. And officially there were 14 albums, but more keep coming out. So it is around 20 because they keep finding things. And over 1,000 shows live. That's scary.
That's a lot. I mean, you get to know a lot about a person.
Well, the closest other musician might have been 600 or 700 shows. Mm-hmm. And what was ironic about it is I was only hired for 8 weeks initially. So the fact, and there was long periods of time I was playing jazz and wasn't with him, but I was with him in those heydays in the 70s, and then I was with him from the 90s till his last performance. And what's fascinating, and didn't dawn upon me until someone pointed it out to me, but I auditioned with the song Changes in 1972, when Mick Ronson was sitting at the piano when he gave me the music. And that was my audition song, and the last piece I ever played with him live was with him, me, and Alicia Keys, and it was Changes in 2006. So it's kind of interesting, what would you call it?
Yeah. Connection to that one song.
One song, and it's like bookends, you know. And like I said, there have been about 100 singers who've just jumped in for a tune or two, and they keep coming, whether it was Perry Farrell or Ian from The Cult, or Sting did two shows with us at the Wiltern.
At the Wiltern, which was phenomenal.
He did Black Star and Lazarus to Die For. I did Disco King, Bring Me to Disco King with Seal. Did you see that?
I saw that, yes. One? That actually happened. I just was watching that again yesterday. That actually happened just a few days after we were together the first time.
Was that a few days after?
Yeah. Oh, well, at least that's when they put the... might have even just been like one day after, because somebody put the video up a few days after.
Wow. He was terrific. And the first week in March, when we're here in California, and Evan Rachel Wood is going to join us. So she's going to be a guest. So you never know who's going to pop in. I mean, almost every artist I've ever met has a close feeling about David, and he's somehow influenced them.
Just yeah, that huge. Magic.
Huge.
Yeah, I know. I mean, when I talk to you about, you know, how he recorded and how he utilized musicians, and I realized in my own two albums, I did the same thing. I gave the musicians full freedom because I knew they were going to give me exactly what I wanted to hear.
Well, that's a good template to follow.
Yeah, I totally agree. And it isn't interesting how subconsciously that was influencing me. I didn't even know it.
Well, as humans, it's very natural if we get out of our own way to let things just flow and be in the moment. And it comes, so it's not like David invented that, or you invented it, or either. It's the natural way. You just have to trust yourself to allow the experience to happen. And sometimes, if we've had bad experiences or bad performance doing that, we shy away from it. So then we go a little more formulaic. And but you have to get up and pull yourself up by the bootstraps and get in there again, because otherwise, I couldn't be doing music at this part of my life if I wasn't being fresh with it. Even this version of the Bill Evans piece I wrote, it was totally different than I've ever played it. And I play it different with the rhythm section and different with a horn player. It's you have to be in the moment and trust that the music will unfold. Does it all the time? Well, maybe not, but you still have to be committed to doing that.
I think that, and even too, if it goes, you know, a lot of songs, as that piece proves, goes through an evolutionary process. Yeah. So each time in the moment that it's created, it's still what that moment wants it to be.
That's right.
And it doesn't have to stay there. That's the beautiful thing about music, is that why would you even think that it should be the same every single night or day? It's like that would be boring.
I think music that is done repetitively, it just comes about from safety and sales. If it's a Broadway show, it kind of has to be similar every night, you know. there are different reasons why that came about. Even the fact that we record music is a little strange, because if you think about it, thousands of years ago, guys are sitting around with some drums banging. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's their religion, or they're trying to reach the gods through it. So it has had many purposes through the years. Of course, record companies and managers and people like that capitalize on it, and the artists need to make a living. So depending on how restrained you are is how much you sell out. If you're not restrained, like myself, I've never allowed anyone to sort of dictate how I create music, and that's why I'm still doing it.
Exactly, because you don't feel like you're doing a formula. I mean, a formula would drive me crazy. I understand, so I get that completely.
Well, you know, if there's anything good about formula, if you're a talented artist, like, and playing classical music, so you are playing the same notes every night if you're playing Liszt or Chopin or Beethoven, you still can play that in the moment and express yourself through it if you have that awareness. And the same as a musical Broadway, you could make it your own, and each time you do it, it's like you've never done it before. That is its own gift. So that would be the upside of formulaic. You know it's going to work, and you want to be respectful of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, or, you know, unless you're announcing that you're going to do improvisations on Beethoven, which I have done things like that, but I'm talking about classical artists. Some will be boring who are not doing it in the moment, and they're just playing the notes, and they might have the fingers, but there's no feeling. The ones who are creating it in the moment, you know, it's great music, so we don't want to lose that music. So there are those that have to do that. I'm not one of them, but I respect that it keeps the music alive. There are people who are playing my improvisations, you know, and I don't want to play them because it's my then music. I did it then. Right. Now I'm playing what I do now, but others who don't improvise. So, I mean, I could see what's positive about formulaic. It's just not who I am. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Oh, totally. I totally understand. I guess I'm a combination of different things. I really don't like doing predictable things.
Right.
Because that's how I put it into words. But
well, that's why we're chatting.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why we're chatting, you know.
And so it's always in the now and always in the moment. And that's how I try to live my life, you know, if not 100% of the time, at least 90% of the time.
Keep it up. Same here.
Yeah, exactly.
Want to play something for you now?
Well, let's see. In 2018, a movie came out, Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh.
And, you know, it was a phenomenal movie.
I liked it very much. It was great.
And I remember when Under Pressure came out, and I was working in a record store at the time, and one of my co-workers came up to me and said, well, it hadn't come out yet, and he said, Dan, you're going to love this. And I said, what do you mean? Two of your favorite artists are going to, like, get together and record? Like, and I was like, what? Yeah, Queen and David Bowie are going to get together and record. Like, I was so excited. I couldn't wait to hear it. And then it was one of those experiences when I first heard it, like, I was just like, this is going to be one of my favorite songs of all time. It was just so well put, and I understood immediately the creative process and what each person did and how it must have come together so spontaneously. So that song, and hearing, you know, I've heard Queen play, but hearing you guys play is the first time that the first band, 2016, the Celebration Band, it was the first time I heard that song get played live. And it was phenomenal. It's a phenomenal song.
Phenomenal. So not everybody can do it, and there's quite a range. And I love the song.
Yeah, I was thinking Something Spontaneous as a tribute to Freddie Mercury and David Bowie.
A combination. Well, the best I could probably do is sort of look into their worlds and their universe when they were here on this planet and maybe wherever they might be now. And the only thing I could probably do that would be honest would be to do a homage to them. So I'm more than happy to do that.
Does that sound great?
Yeah, that's right.
Let's do that and see how it works. Thank you. was fantastic.
Didn't know where that one was going to go, but I found some space. Yeah, I enjoyed it. Especially towards the end, I kind of started to find it.
Yeah.
Sometimes it takes a little time to get in the groove, and then it just happens. I love it, you know. And I'm getting a lot more inspired lately too. And I would have to thank you for that, contributing to that.
My pleasure. If you don't start to pay it forward, at sometime when do you?
That's very, very true. Mm-hmm. I couldn't have said that one better, because that's what I'm feeling. Is like there's an urgency, personally and also beyond me, because music, as you know, it just. It's to me, it makes music makes the connection to something that we can't explain, and that is one of the reasons why I like it.
And the instrumental aspects of it, even without lyrics, can be very, very potent, and because it goes in some ways deeper than words, you know. And we don't understand exactly what it is, but we know there's a healing element there, a big healing element, big one.
And we're on the same page, because that's exactly where I was going. Mm-hmm. Because in 2018 also, you know, I was able to experience your music for healing, the symphonic music for healing, you know, with Jim Walker, and was it Denny Sewell that worked with Paul McCartney? And
that's right. That was my second healing suite. The first one you had missed, it was in 2015, I think, or 14. And then the one you saw was with Denny. He was a great drummer, and my grandsons played on the
Family Affair. Jacob, right?
Jacob and Max played some drums. Mm-hmm. Listen, when I grew up, music was, we thought, enriching. And my dad used to say, music soothes the savage beast. Oh, I grew up with that. I grew up with that. And we knew it certainly as entertainment. I played in Vegas as a kid and all these places. But as you get older and you really see how potent it is, especially if that's your intention. And it doesn't just have to be healing suites like I wrote, that the first one was written for older folks and people with Parkinson's and what have you. If a person is a Bowie fan or a Queen fan, that music is going to heal them. They didn't use those words at the time, but if you think about how people are attached to their iPhones and the iPods in the early days and the earplugs in there and they're walking around town, people are listening. There's got to be right now probably 500 million people listening to music of some sort. Absolutely. Around the world. So it's part of our fabric, but sometimes we don't acknowledge just how amazing it is. It's there, but we miss saying it, so we take it for granted sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. I have to acknowledge the importance of music in my life. I mean, I think it got me through a lot of situations.
I was playing in London a week ago, right now, and this girl comes up to me because we were doing some photos and things of that nature, and she said, in 1973, my piano playing on the Aladdin Sane album saved her life. She was going to commit suicide.
Really?
And I said, well, was it the lyrics of the David's music? She said, no, it was your piano playing. Because I felt a healing element in it. I was humbled and shocked, because I wouldn't have been thinking of that in my 20s. I was just playing as good as I could play for David.
Yeah.
But the music has layers and wavelengths that pass, and this is what she experienced. Consequently, there was a lot of domestic violence in the family, and that's why the music saved her. And then her mother committed suicide, and she went back to the music that saved her again. Wow. This is just a fan that showed up at the show, but obviously more than a fan. And then you start to realize this is serious matter. It's no joke.
Yes.
It's no joke. So it's very humbling, you know. So my job is just to keep creating, keep practicing, keep performing, composing. Some of it is just as simple as exercising so you can keep your strength, exercising your fingers, playing scales, all that kind of stuff, and that's where my commitment is.
Exactly. And wow, it's like that's a lot of what I do some days. If the writing isn't happening, I just play the scales, I play the warm-up exercises, so I can say my fingers are warmed up, or do vocal exercises. My vocal cords are warmed up. I mean, there's always
something. There's no creativity coming through.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You always can work on technique, and that's a good time to do it. If I'll never put the technique above the creation of the music. So if I'm doing scales and all of a sudden a piece comes to me, I'll stop and start recording the piece. But if it doesn't come, I can do it for hours. And I used to practice scales 2 hours before I played a note of music for at least 15 years.
Wow.
2 hours with a metronome.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I used to have a metronome. I don't know what happened to it.
Well, you can get it on. There's many apps that have it now. Just put it on your phone.
That's true. That's very
true. That's where I use them now.
Yeah. Yeah, that in 2019, let's catch up to where we are now, where we're headed to in 2020. 2019, the show I saw at the Orpheum. The Orpheum show.
That was the Orpheum show.
The Orpheum show.
Yeah. It was a nice one, right?
It was a nice,
nice show.
Corey is what, he really impressed me.
Did you like the way he did Young Americans?
Yes, I did. And
it's very, very good. Big talent. And to see someone who comes from a whole other world embracing this music, I love it. I love it. He sang Young Americans great. He did Man Who Sold the World on different gigs and Suffragette City. And he loves the music. I'm glad he's going to be with me this year.
He's
in Europe and Israel and in America.
Fantastic. He's a phenomenal singer. I remember the first time I think I saw him on Saturday Night Live with the band.
With the band. Yeah. You know, the band, the whole Living Colors sat in with me the first year after David passed in New York City, one show. So we're in the middle of this Bowie thing, and the whole band comes up. Could you imagine changing over while there's no break or intermission? The drummer's setting up and the bass player and Corey. And I said, what do you guys want to do? So all my musicians went off the stage. They said, well, I want to do I'm Afraid of Americans.
Oh, really?
So I said, well, I want to play with you, because the drummer and I have a big connection, because we both like John Coltrane, and Elvin Jones, who was the drummer with Coltrane. So he kind of comes from that world. So I was playing this real raucous stuff, which wasn't on the original album, but I've done live since. And their band, while it was not like the Bowie version, because they're a total different group, they captured something really strong.
Maybe did that get recorded?
No, but maybe it's on some YouTube with someone's phone, you know, probably a horrible recording. But these days, almost anything you could see that someone has done live. But it was fantastic. But then, obviously, that's that band. We just needed Corey to travel with us because I was working with the rest of our alumni.
And then I know you did a project, with Perry Farrell, I think, too, right?
I'm on his new album that Tony Visconti produced.
Oh, really? Cool.
And there's 3 or 4 tracks I'm playing on. I'm telling you, they're wonderful. And the last track is just gorgeous. And he's a big talent. And he has now sat in with us twice over the last 3-4 years. And he loves David's music. And he's a wild character and a big talent.
I saw him also do a show with Yoko Ono and the Plastic Ono Band at the Orpheum. He sang with them. I can't remember what he sang, though.
I didn't see that one, but I saw him recently playing downtown in L.A., and it was great. Yeah, nice. Great band.
Then in 2019, you did a project again with Trent Reznor of the Nine Inch Nails, the HBO series Watchmen, right?
If you watch the first 3 minutes of the first Watchmen, now they're into about the fourth or fifth one, it's me playing for 3 minutes silent movie music from like 1910 or 20. Trent asked me to compose some music for that, and I was flattered, and it opens up the series, and it's on vinyl now, and it's on a CD. So you know how these days those scores go on CDs, and this one is right now only on vinyl, I was very much enjoyed doing that project, so. He calls me every few years for something. Mm-hmm. He called me Christmas last year to do a Christmas show at the Palladium. I did 2 nights with him. And right before I went on stage, he asked me to play something Christmas-like that would lead into one of the songs that I played on one of his records. So he said, but be in the same key. And I thought, I'll do Greensleeves, because Greensleeves was in the key of the piece we were going to do. And the audience loved it. It was a band liked it. And then they came out. He called me about 5 years ago, 6 years ago. They were retiring once again. You know, bands like to retire 50 times.
Exactly.
And I did that show. I did some piano playing Gone Girl, which he did the score for.
Mm-hmm.
He's an ally. He's a friend. David adored him. And David said to me, this is in the 90s, he said, keep your eye on this guy. And look what his career has been, and look what he's doing with the films now. His scores are great.
Mm-hmm,
him
mm-hmm.
and Atticus, they're doing a great job. I'm very, very proud of them as younger musicians and just very talented.
It's great to bring people together that you wouldn't even expect would come together.
Yeah, I did a week before I did that last year. Billy Corgan called me to do something down in the Forum. Mm-hmm. Gigantic. It was one of these big Christmas specials.
Mm-hmm.
They had 3 days or 2 days and 20, 30 bands. And I had not even a rehearsal, a sound check, and it was just me and him. We did, I forget which song of his, but it was just amazing, you know, just to reconnect, because I hadn't played with him for several years. So these people all were influenced by David. That's mm-hmm. what's very fascinating. And they grew up. They were 8, 10, 12, 14 years old, and I was in my late 20s. And so that's when you're very influenced by music, no less 13, 14, 15. Those years between 8 and 16, 17, anytime I meet people who liked something at that point in time, like I liked Bill Evans when I was 16, it remains with you your whole life, because that's your formative years, and that music means a lot to you. So you got to be very respectful of those phases of people's life.
Oh, absolutely. And I was young when I first heard Space Oddity and Genie, I think it was, you know, and I realized, this is the same guy? Oh, I love this then. I mean, it was the whole variety thing, right? That was the first thing, besides the fact, you know, that they were great songs. I mean, it was just the fact that they sounded completely different.
Completely different. And believe it or not, on this tour coming up, I'm doing the whole Diamond Dogs album in the first half, so in order of the record. I'm actually having to relearn it. I was at those sessions mm-hmm, with him, mm-hmm. but, you know, it's 45 years, so I'm having to dig in to that. And then the second half will be, in Europe anyway, the second half will be hits and some deeper catalog, like Conversation Piece and some pieces I just choose that I love. But in America, the second half, we're going to do Ziggy Stardust. So the first half will be the Diamond Dogs, and then the second half, Ziggy, and then some encores again, whatever I feel like doing, probably Life on Mars and things that I really love, you know.
Yeah, that's going to be fantastic. I know you're passing through Pasadena. That's one of the many places here in California.
I mean, the first few years it was the Wilton, then the Orpheum. This year it's the Rose in Pasadena, and I've never been there. I hear it's fun to play there, so I'm looking forward to that.
It's a very intimate place, and you'll love it.
Yeah, I think that's on March. I'm guessing it's March
3rd?
No, that's in San Diego.
5th?
I think we're there the 5th. I think we're there the 5th. So I look forward to that.
That's fantastic. And that's going to be, because you did 60 shows last year, so you're going to do 40 shows next year?
40 shows starting in January, including Europe. Looking forward to getting over to Israel. I seem to get there every 3-4 years. I played there with David in the 90s and in a park in Tel Aviv. There was 20,000 people supposedly let in, but everyone was sneaking in, so there was 25,000-30,000 people, and they loved his music. And so I look forward to playing there, and then we'll come back to the States and be here and be at the Rose.
Fantastic. So that, any other projects that you have coming up or that you didn't mention already?
There probably are, but I can't remember right now, because there's always something bizarre happening that I know nothing about, and it comes out of nowhere. One of the things that, when I look over I'm playing professionally now 60 years. I started at 14. So I'm playing professionally. And all the best gigs I had, I never seemingly had anything to do with. They just came out of nowhere. And that's still happening. There are certain things I plan for, or I go out and do this gig or that gig, but the things that have been magical, like getting a call to do Watchmen or play with the Pumpkins or Niners, out of nowhere, or Bowie, out of nowhere. And so that's very enjoyable, again, if you trust and allow the universe to sort of do its thing.
Exactly.
I mean, even playing these pieces today, or playing this piece you asked, I mean, we didn't really discuss that. So you had to trust, because now we're recording, and you have no alternative but to make it good. You know, but it came out of nowhere.
Exactly, and that's what makes it those moments so beautiful. When if you look back on them, somebody would ask you, "What were you feeling at that time?" Like, gosh, I don't even know.
No,
I just was in the moment, and I just, you know.
Well, there was a guy named Wayne Dyer. I don't know if you read any of his books. He took the word nowhere and made it now here.
Oh yeah.
So it was very cool.
Yeah, those are two of my favorite words.
Yeah. I'm sure.
Yeah, and now we're here.
Now we're here.
And are you feeling any musical spontaneity?
I think with those two pieces, I think I captured the jazz thing, and then this thing for Freddie and David. I think I've said it. I mean, I could always play, but I think we got it.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
And are you satisfied?
Oh, it's great. Yeah, it's been great talking to you again and catching up.
You caught up, and it's amazing. You seem to have a better tracking of my life than me, which is a good thing. So if I lose my mind, I can always call you.
Absolutely. Always feel free to reach out.
Yeah,
and
you see more shows than most people, certainly, that have interviewed me, you know.
Yeah, and also too, feel free to share music, and I've enjoyed that, like the old Lang Syne you sent, and it's beautiful, and I'll do the same if I come across a video or something like that, and just keep it going, and I hope one day I can work with you. We can do some stuff together and see where the universe leads it, because I feel more and more of a need to bring my music back, because it did work in Indiana. And people loved it. I came out of nowhere and got to work with, people like John Mellencamp's drummer and play live shows on TV.
Kenny
had just retired from Mellencamp. And it was his new drummer had been with him for 6 months. And he was great to work with him. He's worked with Melissa Manchester, and he played on stage with The Who recently when they were in Indianapolis. And so, yeah, it's worked with great musicians, some of the best, and worked with some of the best promoters, and still a very pleasant time in my life. And it's like the universe is saying, at some point you got to get back to doing that again.
Do it.
Yeah,
I say do it.
Thank you so much, Mike, and thank you for taking the time out of your day today, and it's always a pleasure speaking with you and being on the Now Man Show. Anything else you'd like to say in closing?
Grateful to be able to play the piano. Very grateful.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Mike. And thank you for watching the Now Man Show. This is Niswander. Stay always in the present moment now. Thank you.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. What would you call that?
That's called Stella by Starlight. It's an old standard that was in a ghost movie back in the 50s or 40s. But it's an old just standard that pianists play and singers sing. But it was my variations on it.
That's fantastic. The past is gone.